Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. With the text of Zad Al-Mastaqnia, authored by Imam Al-Hajjawi in the book of Hajj and Umrah. We've reached now where the Imam, he left us off, where he said, Bab Mahdurat Al-Ihram, the chapter pertaining to those things which are forbidden for the person in the state of Ihram. Sheikh Mansour, in his book, explanation of Zad Al-Mastaqnia, تعليق المقنع على زاد المستقنع شيخ منصور, he says مناسبة الباب لما تكلم المؤلف على الإحرام وكيفيته. The appropriateness of this chapter is because the author, he has spoken about the إحرام and how the إحرام is supposed to be done. ذكر بعد ذلك ما يمنع على المحرم فعله إذا دخل في الإحرام. So then the author, he has spoken about what is prohibited upon this person in the state of Ihram, prohibited upon the Muhrim, what's prohibited for him to do whilst in the state of Ihram. وَالْمَحْذُورَاتِ جَمْ مَحْذُورِ المحذورات, the word محذورات is the plural of محذور. وَالْحَذْرُ لُغَةً, and this word, it has a linguistic meaning, which is الْمَنَعُ. محذور has the meaning of حَذْر, which is مَنَعُ, which is to be prevented from and to be forbidden from. وَمِنْهُ قَوْلُ تَعَالَى, and this meaning comes in the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا كَانَ عَطَاءُ رَبِّكَ مَحْذُورًا, and the provisions of your Lord are not mahdhur, meaning they are not forbidden, they are given continuously, they are not prevented. So this was in Surah Al-Isra. So we find from the verse that we've just quoted, there is a linguistic connection between that verse and the meaning of the word mahdhurat, which, as we said, means al-mana', which means prevention and being forbidden from. So al-murad biha, the intent with it here in this chapter, al-umur allati yamna al-muhrim minha, is the things that the muhrim is forbidden from doing, prevented from doing. The author, he says, wa hiya tis'atun, and they are nine things. Al-a'imma bi-istiqra'ihim al-nusus dhakaru anna mahdurat al-ihram tis'a. Sheikh Mansour, he says that the scholars of this ummah, the leading scholars and imams of this ummah, they looked into the texts of the Quran and the Sunnah, and having done so, they came to the conclusion that the mahdurat, the forbidden actions upon the one in the state of ihram, are nine items, nine things. The author, he said, قَوْلُهُ حَلْقُ شَعْرٍ. The first of them is to cut one's hair. حَلْقُ شَعْرٍ وَالْمُرَادْ بِهِ. Sheikh Mansour says, cutting of the hair and what's intended here, إِزَالَةُ شَعْرٍ بِأَيِّ وَجْهٍ كَانٍ, is the removal of the hair in any way, shape or form. So وَأَنْ كَانَ بِالْحَلْقِ, whether that's by cutting the hair, أو نطف, or by pulling out the hair, أو القص, or shaving the hair, أو غير ذلك, or other than that. وَالدَّلِيلُ عَلَى هَذَا الْمَحْذُورِ, and the evidence for this prohibition, is al-kitab wa sunnah wal ijma, is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sunnah and the ijma, the consensus of the ulama. Firstly, amma al-kitab, as for the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, faqawluhu ta'ala, Allah saying, wa la tahliku ra'usakum hatta yablugha al-hadyu mahallahu, and do not cut your hair until the sacrificial animal reaches its place, meaning do not cut your hair until you have freed yourself from the state of ihram by doing the act of sacrificing the sacrificial animal. And as for in the sunnah, the evidence we have in the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim from Ka'b ibn Ujra, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said humiltu ila nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I was carried to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or brought to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wal qamlu yatanatharu ala wajhi, and there were lice falling all over my face from my hair, meaning that his hair was infested with lice. So the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا كُنْتُ أَرَىٰ أَنَّ الْجَهْدَ قَدْ بَلَغَ بِكَ هَذَا, I didn't think that your state of difficulty would reach such a state. أَمَّا تَجِدُ شَاتٍ, do you not find a sheep that you can sacrifice? So Ka'b, he said, قُلْتُ لَا, he said, I don't. The Prophet ﷺ said, سُمْ ثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامٍ, fast for 3 days, أَوْ أَطْعِمْ سِتَّةَ مَسَاكِينٍ, or feed 6 poor people, لِكُلِّ مِسْكِينٍ نِصْفُ صَاعٍ مِنْ طَعَامٍ, for every poor person you will give half of a sa' worth of food. وَحْلِكْ رَأْسَكَ, and then cut your hair. So this is the point from it that the Prophet ﷺ is saying to him, do one of these things as a penalty and then go ahead and cut your hair. فَنَزَلَتْ فِيَّ, then it was revealed regarding me, Ka'b says, It was revealed regarding me, the ayah which we just quoted. This was revealed specifically for me, khasatan wa hiya lakum amatan, specifically for me, and in general it was revealed for everybody else. So we have the evidence that you shouldn't cut your hair from the Quran, and we have the evidence from the sunnah that we mentioned. The Prophet ﷺ showed that the Ka'b ibn Ujrah, because he had so much lice in his hair, the Prophet ﷺ wanted him to cut it. But before doing that, the Prophet ﷺ said to him, you have to pay a penalty. And he went through the different penalties that needed to be paid. So this shows that it's forbidden. Thirdly, we have from the ijma, the consensus of the ulama, فَحَكَّاهُ ibn Mundhir. And Imam ibn Mundhir, he brought about ijma on this issue, as did other ulama. Sheikh Mansour, he says, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْإِزَالَةَ الشَّعْرِ لَا تَخْلُو مِنْ حَالَتَيْنِ. Know that removing the hair doesn't go beyond two situations, meaning that there's two situations pertaining to removing the hair. The first of them, إِزَالَتُهُ مِنَ الرَّعْسِ, removing the hair from the head. فَهَذَا مَمْنُوعٌ بِالْإِجْمَاءِ, so this is forbidden by consensus. The second of them, إِزَالَتُهُ وَأَخْتُ مِنْ بَقِيَةِ الْبَدَنِ, removing hair from the body. From any part of the body, كَشَارِبْ وَعَانَ وَغَيْرُهُمَا, whether it be from your moustache or whether it be from the pubic hairs or other than that. فَالْمَذْهَبْ أَنَّ حُكْمُهُ حُكْمَ شَعْرُ الرَّأْسِ. So the madhab, the ruling in the madhab, is that it has the same ruling as removal of the hair, which is that it is forbidden to do so. Sheikh Sami Abdurrahman al-Nabahani, hafidhullah, in his explanation of Zad al-Mustaqni, he says that it's the Hanbali opinion that the muhrim, the one in the state of ihram, can wash his hair if he needs to do so, even though he's in the state of ihram, and he can run his fingers through his hair if he needs to do so. There's no harm in that, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The second of the things which is mentioned, which are forbidden for the muhrim, the person in the state of ihram, wa taqlimu al-adhafir, is the cutting of the nails. So Sheikh Mansour, he says, مِنَ الْمَحْذُورَاتِ تَقْلِيمُ الْأَظْفَارِ, from the prohibitions upon the muhrim is the cutting of the nails. وَالدَّلِيلُ عَلَىٰ هَذَا الْمَحْذُورِ, and the evidence for this prohibition is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hajj, ثُمَّ الْيَقْضُ تَفَثَهُمْ وَالْيُوفُ نُذُورَهُمْ وَلَتَوَّفُوا بِالْبَيْتِ الْعَطِيقِ. In Surah Al-Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they should complete this rite, they should fulfill tafathahum, and they should fulfill their vows, and they should make tawaf at the Kaaba, at the Bayt al-Atiq. Well, tafath, Sheikh Mansour, he says, the word tafath in the ayah, maqsood bihi, the intent of it, is taqlimul adhfar, is the cutting of the nails. Wal halqul ana, and the removing of the pubic hair, wa nahwi dhalik, and other things which are related to these issues. وَعَلَى هَذَا فَلَا يَأْخُذُ الْإِنسَانِ مِنْ أَذْفَارِهِ شَيْئًا. So based upon this, the person is not allowed to take anything from his nails. سَوَاءً أَذْفَارِ يَدَيْنِ, whether those are the nails of the hands, أو رجلين, or of the feet. وَسَوَاءً أَزَالَهَ بِالْقَلْعِ أو الْقَصْ أو غَيْرِهِمَا, and whether the person removes the nails by cutting them or by pulling them out completely. So this is not allowed. Sheikh Mansour, he says, وَعْلَمْ, he says, no, أَنَّ إِزَالَةَ الشَّعْرِ وَالْأَذْفَارِ مَحْضُورٍ, that the removal of the hair and the nails is something which is forbidden. إِلَّا أَنَّهُ يُسْتَثْنَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ حَالَتَانِ, except that from it, two situations are exempt. The first of them, إِذَا كَانَ قَدْ آذَاهُ, if it harms the person, the hair or the nails are harming the person, then it's allowed to remove them. He gives an example, كَأَنْ يُخْرِجَ شَعْر بِأَيْنِهِ, for example, if one of the hairs is dangling in your eye, okay, أو ينكسر ظفره, or one of your nails has become broken, فيزيل ما بقي منه, then the person wants to remove this, the rest of the nail, then that is allowed because the broken nail is harming him. So it's either that there's a hair in your eye and that's coming into your eye, you want to remove it, that's okay, that's allowed for you, as an exception, or your nail is broken and it's harming you, then you are allowed to remove that. He also said, إِذَا أَزَالَ مَعَ غَيْرِهِ, إِذَا أَزَالَهُ مَعَ غَيْرِهِ, if he was to remove the hair or the nail in a situation where it's connected to other than those things. I'll explain this. So he removes it with other, he removes those forbidden issues with other than them. كَمَا لَوْ قُطِعَ أُنْوَلَةُ إِصْبَعِهِ وَعَلَيْهَا ظُفْرٌ, as for example, if his fingertip was cut off, and with it, of course, with his nail, then therein there is no problem. أو احتاج لقطع شيء من جلده وعليه بعض الشعر فيجوز. Or for example, he needed to remove part of his skin for whatever reason, and on that skin there was some hair. So due to this situation, he's allowed to remove the hair. والقاعدة الفقهية المقررة, and the established fiqh rule which allows this is as follows. أنه يثبت تبعا ما لا يثبت استقلالا. That the ruling of the issue when it's connected to something else is different to the ruling when it is independent. So we know independently that to remove the hair or the nail is forbidden. But if it's connected to something else that you have to remove, then it has a completely different ruling, which is that it's allowed. So in the examples we gave, for example, if the nail is broken and it's harming you and then you have to remove it, or the fingertip was cut and due to that the nail of course was removed, or a person has to remove some skin and on that skin there is hair, so then the hair is removed with the skin, then in this situation, due to the fiqh rule that we mentioned, then it's permissible to do so. وهنا قطع الظفر مع غيره لا باستقلاله. And in the situations that we mentioned, the removal was due to other than it, not due to the item, the forbidden item in of itself. The author, he says, فَمَنْ حَلَقَ أَوْ قَلَّمَ ثَلَاثَةً. If a person cuts three hairs or removes three nails, Sheikh Mansour, he says, فعل المحذور من المحذورات فيه فدية. That when you do something which is forbidden upon the muhrim, you have to pay a fidya. You have to pay a fidya. How do we translate fidya? You have to pay a fine. You have to pay a fine for having done that forbidden action. لكن الفدية في إزالة الشعر والأظفار تترتب في شعر بإزالة ثلاث شعرات وفي أظفار بإزالة ثلاثة أظفار. However, the fine, the fidya, which you have to pay, it only comes about if you remove three hairs or you remove three nails. And the fidya, what they mean here, they mean that the fidya here would be the fidyatul adha. It's known as fidyatul adha, which is that you have to sacrifice a sheep or a goat or something of that nature. You have to sacrifice a sheep or a goat. However, Sheikh Amr Bahjat, he said, if it's the case that the person has removed less than three hairs or less than three nails, then the situation is as follows. For one hair or one nail, then the person has to feed one poor person. For two hairs or two nails, then the person has to feed two poor people. So again, the author, he said, فَمَنْ حَلَقَ أَوْ قَلَّمَ ثَلَاثَةً فَعَلَيْهِ الدَّمْ. The one who cuts three hairs or three nails, then he has to pay them. And them is the fidya, it's the penalty which has to be paid when somebody does these items which are forbidden in the state of ihram. And what is intended by them, we'll come to know now. إِذَا حَلَقَ شَعْرَهُ, Sheikh Mansour says, if he cuts his hair, أَوْ قَلَمَ ذُفْرَهُ, أَوْ removes his nails, وَثَبَتَتْ عَلَيْهِ الْفِدْيَةِ, then the fine is established upon him, فَإِنَّهُ يَذْبَحُ شَيْطًا, then he has to sacrifice a sheep. ويشترط فيها ما يجزئ في الأضحية, and it's conditional in that sacrificial animal, which is conditional upon the sacrificial animal which is given on Eid al-Adha. And these conditions of which animals are allowed to sacrifice or not allowed to sacrifice, we will discuss this later on in a few chapters. So as a quick recap, so the person, if he takes more than three hairs or if he takes three or more nails, then this person has to pay the fidya, and the fidya is shat, fidyatul dam. He has to sacrifice a sheep or a goat. And if it's less than that, if it's less than three hairs, if it's one hair or two hairs, or one nail or two nails, then he has to feed for each of those a poor person. The author, he said, مَنْ غَطَّ رَأْسَهُ بِمُلَاسِقٍ فَدَى. Whoever covers his head with something covering the head, touching the head, then this person also has to give a fidya, also has to pay the penalty, which is upon the person doing something which is haram whilst in being the state of ihram. So it's forbidden to cover your hair with that which touches your hair. The mu'tamad opinion, the relied upon opinion in the madhab, as stated by Sheikh Mutlaq Jasir, is that even if it's not mulasiq, even if it's not touching your head, but it's over your head, covering your head without touching your head, then this also counts as that which is forbidden. And the evidence for this is in the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about the one who fell off his camel and he died whilst in the state of ihram. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Wala tukhammiru ra'sahu," and do not cover his head. So we know that from this hadith that to cover your head whilst in a state of ihram is something which is forbidden. Sheikh Amir Bahjat, he said, if one needs to carry goods upon his head, there's a real need for him to do that, then it's allowed for him. But he doesn't put goods on his head if he's hoping to do by that to cover his head from the sun. So it's only your head is allowed to be covered carrying goods if there's no other way for you to carry those goods. And also he mentions that if one uses an umbrella, then the person has to pay the fidya, he has to pay a penalty. But he doesn't have to pay it if one carries the umbrella for him. Likewise, if one raises a shimagh, a scarf over his head like so, okay, then he has to pay a fidya, he has to pay the penalty. But not in the situation where two people take either end of that scarf and they hold it up over the head for the person. Why is this? The Hanbali scholars, they separate in ruling between that which moves due to the person himself as opposed to that which moves due to other than the person. So for example, if I'm holding an umbrella, that shade is moving with me due to me. But if somebody's holding that umbrella for me, then that shade is moving with me but not due to me. So this is how they differentiate. So thus a person taking shade under a tent and issues like that is fine, there's no problem in it whatsoever. The author, he says, وَإِن لَبِسَ ذَكْرٌ مَخِيطٌ فَدَى. If a person wears مَخِيط, then the person has to pay the fidya. If he wears مَخِيط, if he wears clothing which is مَخِيط, then he has to pay a fidya. Can somebody tell me from the previous class, if they were here, what is the meaning of مَخِيط? If somebody attended the previous class, please tell me what was the meaning of مَخِيط. So we said that the makhit is that clothing which is stitched clothing and it's made in a way that it fits the parts of the body. So Sheikh Mansour, he says, min al-mahdurat, from the things which are forbidden, lubsul makhit, the wearing of stitched clothing. Wa dabitu fil makhit amran, and the condition of knowing what is makhit is two things. Sheikh Mansour says the first of them, an yukhat ala qiyas kull al-badan, is that this clothing is made in the shape of the whole body. أو على عدو من أعضائه, or it's made in the shape of a part of the body. كثوب والكوت, like for example wearing a thobe or wearing a coat والسروال, or wearing those long pajamas or فانيلة, or wearing a t-shirt or something of that nature ونحوها, or something of that nature. So مخيط firstly is that which is made in the shape of the whole body or the shape of a part of the body. Secondly, أن يلبس على ما خيط ووضع له. Secondly, it's when you wear that clothing for its intended purpose. So I wear the thobe as a thobe, I wear the shirt as a shirt, I wear the jacket as a shirt. فلو تحزم بثوب أو جعله رداء فلا بأس. However, Sheikh Mansour says that if you were to take the thobe, for example, and you were to wrap it around your waist as an izar, then in this situation there's no problem. So even though the thobe is stitched and it's makhit, it's made in the shape of your body, but because here you're wearing it for other than that which it was made for, then there's no problem there. And we mentioned previously in last week's class that if you were to wear a jacket, not with your arms in the sleeves, but just over your shoulders, then that would be fine if you needed to do so, because you're not wearing it for its intended purpose. وَالدَّلِيلُ عَلَى حَدَ الْمَحْذُورِ, and the evidence for this forbidden action, the wearing of the مَخِيط, the wearing of stitched and shaped clothing, is what we find in Bukhari and Muslim, the hadith of Ibn Umar, where أَنَا رَجُلٌ قَالَ, a person said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, O Prophet of Allah, مَا يَلْبَسُ الْمُحْرِمُ مِنَ الثِّيَابِ, what does the muhrim wear from clothing? So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لَا تَلْبَسُ الْقُمَسُ, do not wear shirts, وَلَا عَمَائِمُ, and do not wear turbans, ولا سراويلات, and do not wear pajamas, ولا البرانسة, and do not wear البرانسة. البرانسة are those wide type of cloak clothings that have hoods, something similar to what the Moroccans wear, ولا الخفاف, and do not wear الخفاف, socks, feet covering. Okay, وَالْإِجْمَاءُ مُنْعَقِدٌ عَلَىٰ هَذَا. And there is a consensus on this issue. نَقْلَهُ إِبْنُ مُنْذِرٍ وَغَيْرُهُ. Ibn Munzir, Imam Ibn Munzir, brought about this consensus, as did other imams, as did other imams. وَعَلَىٰ هَذَا شَيْخ مَنْصُورُ says, so based upon this, فَلَا يَجُوزْ لُبْسُ مَا خُيْتَ عَلَىٰ الْبَدْنِ. Therefore, it's not allowed to wear that which is stitched and made to wear on a part of the body or all of the body. أو على عدو من أعضائه سواء كان مما نص عليه, whether that clothing is from what the Prophet ﷺ specifically mentioned, أو مما يقاس عليه من نظائره, or from that which قياس is made based upon similar items. So you find, for example, the Prophet ﷺ mentions a specific item of clothing, and then we find another item of clothing which is similar to it, so we can make قياس, we can make analogy and derive a ruling saying that this is also forbidden because it's very similar to the clothing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specifically mentioned. The next mahdhur, the next prohibition is the following. The author, he says, may Allah have mercy upon him, وَإِن طَيَّبَ بَدْنَهُ, if the person perfumes his body, أَوْ ثَوْبَهُ, or he perfumes his clothing, أَوْ إِدَّهَنَا بِمُطَيِّبِ, or he uses cream on his hair that has perfume in it, أو شم طيبا, oh, he smells intentionally طيب, he smells intentionally some nice smelling perfume, أو تبخر بعود ونحوي, or he uses عود, عود are these sticks which are used as incense when you burn them, if he smells that or he uses that, فذا, then he has to give a penalty. So من المحذورات الطيب. So Sheikh Mansour says that from the forbidden things is the tib, the perfume. And we have, for example, in Bukhari Muslim, the hadith of Ibn Umar, where he said, وَلَا تَلْبَسُوا مِنَ الثِّيَابِ شَيْئًا مَسَّهُ زَعْفَرَانَ أَوْ وَرْسٌ. We took this in the previous lesson, that the Prophet ﷺ said, do not wear anything whereupon saffron has touched it, أَوْ وَرْسٌ. وَرْسٌ is a plant which gives off a nice smell. So za'faran is explicitly forbidden by the Prophet ﷺ, and we also mentioned that even if it's in food or drink, as long as the smell is there, then it's not permissible for the one in the state of ihram to use these things. So we have also the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim of Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, in the hadith in the hadith of the one who fell off his camel and died, the Prophet ﷺ said, وَلَا تُقَرِّبُوهُ طِيبًا, and don't bring close to him perfume, meaning don't touch him with any perfumes. Sheikh Mutlaq Jasir, hafidhahullah, he says, not all nice smells are forbidden for the person to breathe in. The intent is طيب. If it's perfume, strong perfume, then this is what is forbidden and has to be avoided. However, things like fruits, they can be smelled. Fruits, they have a nice smell to them. So somebody can happily smell a pear or a banana if he wishes to do so. There's no harm in that. And thus, we can conclude, Sheikh Mutlaq Jasir says, that even soaps that don't have any perfume smells in them, but just have their natural standard smell, then those are also allowed to use if one has to do so. However, it's better to avoid not to use them. The author, he says, وَإِن قَتَلَ صَيْدًا مَأْكُولًا بَرِّيًا أَصْلًا. If a person kills, and this is forbidden to do for the muhrim, if the muhrim kills, an animal that is hunted and it's eaten, meaning that it's an animal which is normally eaten, it's normal for the people to eat this animal, if this is hunted and killed, and it's barriyan, it's that animal which lives outside of the domestic nature, meaning it lives in the wild, okay, and this is its original state. We'll explain these points bit by bit, inshallah. So the author, he says, وَإِن قَتَلَ صَيْدًا مَأْكُولًا بَرِّيًا أَصْلًا وَلَوْ تَوَلَّدَ مِنْهُ وَمِنْ غَيْرِهِ. Even if there is a crossbreed between the wild animal and the domestic animal. أَوْ تَلِفَ فِي يَدِهِ. Or this animal, which is wild, dies in his hand without the person actually killing it. فَعَلَيْهِ جَزَاءُهُ. Then in this situation, the person has to pay the value of the animal which has been killed. Let's see what Sheikh Mansour explains here. He says, مِنَ الْمَحْذُورَاتِ قَتْلُ صَيْدٍ. He says, from the forbidden actions is the killing of the animal which is hunted. مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, we have from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showing this prohibition. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْتُلُوا الصَّيْدَ وَأَنْتُمْ حُرُمٌ. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, don't kill the sayd, don't kill the hunted animal whilst you are in a state of ihram. And we have in the Sunnah that the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim of Abi Qatada fi qissati qatlihi al-himar al-wahshi, that Abi Qatada radiyallahu anhu, who was not in a state of ihram, Abi Qatada was not in a state of ihram, however he was accompanying those who were in a state of ihram. So Abi Qatada, he killed a wild donkey. He killed a wild donkey, right? Which was allowed for him to do because he's not in the state of ihram. So the companions who were with him in the state of ihram, they said, وَقَالُوا نَأْكُلُ لَحْمَ صَيْدٍ وَنَحْنُ مُحْرِمُونَ, are we allowed to eat the meat of this animal which has been killed, hunted and killed, whilst we are in a state of ihram? فَحَمَلْنَا مَا بَقِيَ مِنْ لَحْمِهَا, so we carried the remainder of its meat to the Prophet ﷺ. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ, the Prophet ﷺ said, هَلْ مِنْكُمْ أَحَدٌ أَمَرَهُ, is there anybody amongst you who are in the state of ihram that commanded him to kill this animal? أَوْ أَشَارَ إِلَيْهِ بِشَيْءٍ, or pointed to him that he go ahead and kill it? قَالُوا لَا, قَالُوا لَا, they said, no, ya Rasulullah, none of us did that. So the Prophet ﷺ said, فَكُلُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنْ لَحْمِهَا, therefore, go ahead and eat what was left from this meat. It's permissible for you to eat. So the hadith is showing us that had they said to Abi Qatada, kill the animal on our behalf, it would have been haram for them. They would have done something haram. Because telling somebody to kill it on your behalf is as though you have killed the animal yourself. So by virtue of the fact that they didn't hunt this animal, and Abi Qatada hunted the animal whilst not in a state of ihram, then that meat was for them permissible. Also we have the ijma', we have the consensus, mun'aqidun ala dhalik, which is brought about in this issue, naqlahu ibn al-Mundhir, Imam ibn Mundhir and Imam ibn Qudama wa ghayrihima, and other than them brought about the ijma' in this issue. Sheikh Mansour, he says, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَابُدْ فِي الصَّيْدِ الْمَحْذُورِ مِنْ ثَلَاثَةِ الشُّرُوطِ, he said, be aware and take note that for the sayd, for the hunted animal to be forbidden, there are three factors that need to be considered. The first of them, أَنْ يَكُونَ بَرِّيًا, the first of them is that it's barriyan, that it is an animal which is found in the wild. فَيُخْرِجْ صَيْدُ الْبَحْرِ, and this then excludes the ruling of the sayd al-bahr. Sayd al-bahr, which is that which is found in the sea, which is that which is found in the sea, those animals which are found in the sea. وَهَذَا إِذَا كَانَ خَارِجَ مَكَّةَ, and this is for the one who is outside of Mecca. Because the ayah, it says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ صَيْدَ الْبَحْرِ وَطَعَامُهُ مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِسِيَارًا, permissible for you is the dead and that which is hunted from the sea as food for you and for the sayara. وَحُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ صَيْدُ الْبَرِّ مَا دُمْتُمْ حُرْمٌ, and forbidden upon you is that hunted animal in the wild as long as you are in a state of ihram. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ, and have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whom you are going to return to. So the verse is clearly saying to us that hunting the wild animals are not allowed, but the animals of the sea are allowed for us to be hunted as long as that it's outside of Mecca, because in Mecca you're not allowed to hunt even the animals from the sea, the animals of the sea. أما إن كان في مكة, as Sheikh Mansour says now, as for if they were in Mecca, فَيُحْرَمْ حَتَّى صَيْدُ الْبَحْرِ, then it's forbidden even to the extent that the animals of the sea are not allowed to be hunted. The second condition, or the second factor to be considered, أَنْ يَكُونُ مَأْكُولًا, is that this which is hunted, it should be from that which is eaten. أَمَّا غَيْرُ الْمَأْكُولِ فَلَا بَعْسْ بِقَتْلِهِ وَلَا فِدْيَةً, as for that which is not eaten, it's not from those animals which are eaten by the people, then there is no problem in killing it, and there is no penalty, there's no fidya to be paid. There are these الفواسق الخمس, something which is known as الفواسق الخمس, فإن المحرم معمور بقتلها لأنه مؤذية, for verily the person in the state of ihram is commanded to kill these five things because they are harmful to him. And these five things are found in the hadith of Bukhari, where the Prophet ﷺ said, kill these five things, and he called them الفواسق, يعني the evil things, the crow, the kite bird of prey, the scorpion, the mouse, and the rabid dog. The third thing that we have to consider, mentioned by Sheikh Mansour, he said, أَنْ يَكُونُ مُتَوَحِّشًا أَصْلًا, that this animal which is being hunted, which is going to be forbidden, it should be from those animals which are wild originally, meaning that its original nature is that it's a wild animal, not that it became wild. والمتوحش هو الذي لا يستأنس من الدواب غالبا. المتوحش, the wild animal, is that which doesn't يستأنس, that which doesn't become domesticated from the animals in general. أي أصله في البر, meaning that its original status is that it's found in the wild. فغير المتوحش كالبقر والغنم يجوز للمحرم ذبحها. So other than this wild animal, like for example the cow or the goats and the sheep, it's permissible for the muhrim, for the one in the state of ihram, to sacrifice these. لأن الأصل فيها عدم التوحش. Because the original ruling, the original state, is that they are not to be considered as wild. And the evidence is this statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا تقتلوا الصيد وأنتم حرم. Don't kill the صيد, don't kill the animals, the صيد, whilst you are in a state of ihram. فَسَمَّاهُ اللَّهُ صَيْدًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called these animals صيد. وَصَيْدُ لَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا لِلْمُتَوَحَّشَاتِ. And the صيد is not given the title to except for those animals which are المتوحشات, which are wild. أَمَّا الْأَهْلِيَّةِ فَلَا. As for those which are domesticated animals, then the ruling is not given to them. So as a conclusion, those animals which are wild by nature, they're originally wild, they cannot be killed. Okay, whilst in the state of ihram. And those animals which are in the sea can be killed in the state of ihram as long as they are outside, it's done outside of the area of Mecca. The author, he said, aslan. Speaking about the animals, he said aslan, meaning that they should be originally wild. يخرج ما ليس من أصله متوحش. Sheikh Mansour says, this takes out from the ruling that which is not originally wild. كالغنم. For example, a sheep. لو توحشت, if this became wild, meaning it ran away and it became wild. فتبقى على الأصل, then it remains in ruling upon its original foundation, its original ruling. وهو جواز ذبحها, and that is that it is permissible for it to be slaughtered. So if a sheep was to run away and it lived in the wild and it became wild, then that doesn't fall into the ruling of it being forbidden, because its original state is not that, is that it's not wild, rather it's domesticated. And the author, he said, وَلَوْ تَلْوَلَّدَ مِنْهُ وَمِنْ غَيْرِهِ. Even if this animal was bred between a wild animal and a domesticated animal. إِذَا كَانَ سَيْدْ مُتَوَلِّدًا مِنْ الْوَحْشِ وَأَهْلِهِ. If an animal was wild and domesticated and they both mated, they bred, فَإِنَّهُ يَحْرُمْ أَكْلُهُ وَصَيْدُهُ. Then it's still forbidden for it to be eaten and forbidden for it to be hunted. تَغْلِيبًا لِجَانِبِ الْحَذَرِ. Because تَغْلِيبًا لِجَانِبِ الْحَذَرِ, meaning that the ruling is given more consideration to the part of the animal which is wild. And the part of the animal which is wild is the forbidden part. So you have a part which is halal, the domesticated part, and you have a part which is forbidden. So the ruling is given in preference to that which is haram. The haram aspect takes over the complete ruling. And the ruling is given in that situation that even if it was crossbred, half of it wild and half of it not wild, then the ruling is given that it's wild, therefore it cannot be hunted and it cannot be eaten. The author, he said, أَوْ تَلِفَ فِي يَدِهِ فَعَلَيْهِ جَزَاؤُهُ. All this animal which was hunted, maybe he didn't kill it, maybe he didn't eat it, but it died whilst in the person's possession. So in this situation, the person also has to pay a fidya, also has to pay a fine. Sheikh Mansour, he said, إذا كان في يد المحرم صيد بالأوصاف المتقدمة. If the person has in his hand, in his possession, the animal with the descriptions and the factors that we have previously mentioned, ولم يأكله. However, he didn't eat it. لكنه تلف في يده بأي سبب. However, the animal became died in his hand, in his possession, due to any reason. سواءً بمباشرة قتله. Whether that was directly killing the animal, أو بإشارة إليه, or by helping, pointing out to somebody to go ahead and kill the animal, أو إعانة عليه, or helping for it to be killed, فإنه يضمن. Then in all of these situations, the person has to replace the animal, has to pay the penalty by replacing the animal or paying the value of the animal and feeding with that the poor. وذلك لأنه يحرم عليه إمساكه. And all of this is because, in essence, in the original situation, in the first state, it was forbidden for him to grab the animal in the first state. فَكَانَ عَلَيْهِ ضَمَانُهُ إِنْدَ تَلَفِهِ وَهُوَ فِي يَدِهِ. And based upon that, the animal died, even though he didn't kill it, but whilst it was in his possession, he was responsible for it because he should not have taken hold of it in the first place. So he has to pay the fine and the fidya in this situation. Sheikh Ahmed Bahjat mentions an important point here, which many people overlook. He said that locusts are also considered as wild animals, so a person shouldn't kill them whilst in the state of ihram. The author, he said, وَلَا يَحْرُمُ حَيَّوَانٌ آنِسِيٌّ. And those animals which are domesticated are not forbidden upon the muhrim. Sheikh Mansour says, المحرم أو من كان في الحرم لا يحرم عليه صيد ولا تذكية الحيوانات الإنسية. That the muhrim, or the person who is in the sanctuary of the haram, then it's not forbidden upon them to hunt or to kill the domesticated animals, meaning those animals which are not wild. Like, for example, the ibl, like the camel, or the baqr, or the cow, or the ghanim, or the sheep and goat, what the dajjaj, and the chickens, وَنَحْوِهَا, and anything similar to them. وَالْإِلَّا, and the reason for that ruling, أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ بَرِّيَّةً, because they are not barriyah, they are not wild animals that live out in the wild. وَلَيْسَتْ بِصَيْدٍ, and they are not animals which are hunted. وَلِهَذَا كَانَ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, and due to this, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم كَانَ يَذْبَحُ الْبُدْنَ فِي أَحْرَامِهِ بِالْحَرَمِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would sacrifice camels, al-budan, whilst he was in the sanctuary of the haram. And also, وَعَلَى هَذَا, Sheikh Mansour says, based upon this, فَلَوْ نَدَّتْ شَاتْ وَنَحْوِهَا, if a sheep was to run away to the wild, or anything similar to that, وَتَوَحَّشَتْ, and it became wild, فَقَتَلَهَا الْمُحْرِمْ رَمْيًا, and then the muhrim, he killed it by throwing a spear at it. فَهِيَ حَلَال, then this would be halal for him. Why? بَنَاءً عَلَى الْأَصْلِ, based upon the asl, based upon the original situation, the original ruling, أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ مُتَوَحَّشَةً, that this animal, this sheep that ran away and lived in the wild, is not originally wild, it's originally domesticated. So that's where the ruling is applied. The author, he said, وَلَا صَيْدُ الْبَحْرِ, nor is it allowed for the person in the state of ihram to hunt that which is in the sea. Sheikh Mansour says, تَقَدَّمَ أَنَّ صَيْدَ الْبَحْرِ لَا يَحْرُمْ عَلَى الْمُحْرِمِ إِذَا لَمْ يَكُمْ بِالْحَرْمِ. We mentioned previously, Sheikh Mansour says, that the hunting of the sea animals is not forbidden upon the one in the state of ihram, as long as it is not done in the haram, as long as it's not done in the sanctuary of the haram. وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُ تَعَالَى, and the evidence is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ سَيْدُ الْبَحْرِ وَطَعَامُهُ مَتَاءً لَكُمْ لَيْسَيَارًا. As we mentioned previously, that the verse says, it's halal for you, it's permissible for you, the hunting of the animals of the sea, and their food is allowed for you as مَتَاءً لَكُمْ. نعم. لكن ما هو صيد البحر؟ Sheikh Mansour says, what is the صيد البحر? What is known as صيد البحر? What is known as the animals which are hunted? So those animals which are forbidden for you as a muhrim to hunt, if you are in Mecca. Outside of Mecca, you're allowed to hunt them. But if you are in Mecca, you're not allowed to hunt them. So what is this صيد البحر? He said, Sheikh Mansour, هو الحيوان الذي يعيش في الماء. It is that animal which lives in the water. And that animal which hatches in the water and lays its eggs in the water. كالسمك, like fish for example, وسرطان, and crabs, ونحوها, and similar to them. أما ما يعيش في البر والبحر فينهى عنه. As for that which lives in the sea and on the land, then that is forbidden. Why? تغليبا لجانب الحذر. Because the ruling will be given to the forbidden aspect of this animal. So if you have an animal which lives on the land and it also lives in the water, then the fact that it lives on the land, okay, would make it bar, would make it forbidden. But the fact that it lives in the sea would make it halal. So when you have the halal and the haram in one item like this, the ruling is given conclusively to the haram aspect. So the haram aspect takes over the whole issue of the ruling here. So he said, أَمَّا مَا يَعِيشُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ فَيُنْهَى عَنْهُ تَغْلِيبًا لِجَانِبِ الْحَذَرِ كَالطَّيْرِ الْمَاءِ. As, like for example, birds which live in the water, كَالْبَطْ, like ducks, وَنَحْوِهَا, and similar to that. فَهُوَ مِنْ سَيْدِ أَهْلِ الْبَرِّ فِي قَوْلِ عَامَةِ أَهْلِ الْإِلْمِ. So it is from the hunted things of the land in the overall overwhelming statements of the scholars. وَفِيهِ الْجَزَاءِ, and if one does that, then he will have to pay a penalty. So what we just said here is a conclusion in this point, that the sea animals are allowed for you to hunt if you are in a state of ihram, as long as this is not done in Mecca. And if they are animals which live in the sea and outside of the sea, then the ruling is given as though they are haram. But those animals which live only in the sea, they are permissible for you to do, for you to hunt, as long as it's not in Mecca. The author, he says, wala sa'il, nor those which are sa'il. لو صالت بحيمة من سيد البر على المحرم. If one of the animals, the wild animals, was to attack a muhrim, وخاف على نفسه, and the muhrim feared for himself, فإن له أن يدفعها عن نفسه. So this person is permitted to defend himself from the animal, ولو بالقتل, even if he has to kill the animal. إن لم تندفع إلا به. If it's the situation that he cannot defend himself except by killing the animal. وَلَوْ قَتَلَهَا فَلَا ضَمَانَ عَلَيْهِ. And if he was to kill it, then there would be no penalty and no retribution upon him. So this sa'il means that the wild animal, may Allah protect the Muslims, attacks a muhrim, and then this muhrim, he's allowed to defend himself even if it meant that he had to kill the animal, because he was doing it out of self-defense. The author, he says, وَيَحْرُمُ عَقْدُ نِكَاهِ, and it's forbidden to do the act, the عَقْدُ نِكَاهِ, عَقْدُ نِكَاهِ, pronunciation a bit off today, وَيَحْرُمُ عَقْدُ نِكَاهِ, and it's forbidden to do the marriage contract. مِنَ الْمَحْذُورَاتِ, from those things which are forbidden, is عَقْدُ نِكَاهِ, is the marriage contract. And the evidence is in the hadith of Sahih Muslim, Uthman radiallahu anhu said that the Prophet said, لا ينكح المحرم, that the muhrim is not to get married, ولا ينكح, nor is he to give somebody else to be married, ولا يخطب, nor is he to give in make a marriage contract. So in essence, the hadith is saying and proving that the muhrim is not allowed for him to be married. والإجماع, and there's also إجماع here, there's consensus, منعقد على تحريم عقد النكاح على المحرم, that the عقد النكاح, that the contract of nikah is not allowed to be done for the muhrim, and this is by إجماع, by consensus. ولا يصح, the author says, ولا يصح, and it's not valid, even if the act was done, if the nikah was done, it wouldn't be valid. So Sheikh Mansour says, هذا العقد على المحرمة أو للمحرم لا يصح. This contract of marriage, if it was done for the female or the male or both of them in in the state of ihram, then it wouldn't be valid. وَالْإِلَّا, and the reason for that, أَنَّهُ عَقْدٌ مَنْهِيٌ عَنْهُ, because it is a contract which is forbidden. وَالنَّهِي وَارِدٌ عَلَى عَيْنِ الْعَقْدِ, and the prohibition is specific to the act, to the contract itself. وَمَا وَرَدَ النَّهِي عَلَى عَيْنِهِ, and there, that situation with the prohibition relates specifically to the contract itself, فَإِنَّهُ يَحْكُمُ عَلَيْهِ بِالْفَسَادِ, then it is to be given the ruling of it being fasid, fasad. وَسَوَاءً فِي ذَلِكَ كَانَ أَحَدُهُمَا مُحْرِمًا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا, and that situation is whether one of them was in a state of ihram or both of them were in a state of ihram, whether the man or the woman or both of them were in the state of ihram, the situation is the same, that the contract is to be termed as being fasid, being invalid. So Sheikh Amir Bahjat, he mentions the nikah is termed as fasid and not batil. So you have terms for contracts in Islamic terminology, in the Sharia terminology. Sometimes it's mentioned that it's fasid, sometimes it's mentioned that it's batil, that it's invalid. And both of them mean invalid. In fact, fasid means invalid and batil means invalid. They share the same meaning in essence. However, batil is used when all of the ulama agree upon this nikah being forbidden. All of the ulama agree that this type of nikah is forbidden. But in this situation, there are some ulama that allow it. Therefore, the reason, the terminology of fasid is used. Fasad, bil fasad, is used instead of batil. Sheikh al-Hajawi, Imam al-Hajawi, he says, وَلَا فِدْيَةَ, and there is no penalty. So the one who does this act, the one who does fall into this forbidden action of doing a nikah, then it's going to be invalid, but there's no penalty that the person has to pay. The person doesn't have to pay a fidya. Sheikh Mansour, he says, هَذَا الْعَقْدُ لَوْ وَقْعَ فَلَا فِدْيَةَ فِيهِ وَالْعِلَّةِ. Sheikh Mansour says that this, if somebody fell into it, there is no fidya. And the reason is, number one, أَنَّهُ عَقْدٌ فَسَدَ لِأَجْلِ إِحْرَامٍ, because it is an action, it is a contract which became invalid due to the state of ihram. فَلَمْ تَجِبْ بِهِ فِدْيَةً. Therefore, a fidya is not to be given in this situation. And secondly, وَأَنَّهُ لَا يُوجُدْ دَلِيلٌ عَلَى الْفِدْيَةِ, that there is no evidence that a fidya has to be given in this situation. وَالْأَصْلُ بَرَاءَةُ الذِّمَّةِ, and the origin in ruling in this situation is بَرَاءَةُ الذِّمَّةِ. بَرَاءَةُ الذِّمَّةِ meaning that the person is free from responsibility. There's no responsibility upon this person's neck. The author, he said, وَتَصِحُّ الرُّجَعَ. However, a ruj'a is permitted. What is a ruj'a? Firstly, Sheikh Mansour, he says, مُرَاجَةُ الزَّوْجِ لِزَوْجَتِهِ الْمُطَلَّقَةِ الرَّجْعِيَّةَ تَصِحُّ فِي حَالِ الْإِحْرَامِ, that this woman who is, she's speaking in the talaq of ruj'a, talaq al-raj'i, then she is allowed to be returned to the husband. Why is that? لِأَنَّ الْمُرَاجَةَ لَيْسَتْ بِنِكَاحٍ جَدِيدٍ, because this muraja'a, this returning of her to her husband, is not a new contract. إِنَّمَا إِسْتَدَامَةُ لِلنِّكَاءِ, rather it's a continuation of the previous, of their previous marriage contract. إِذْ هِيَ زَوْجَتُهُ, as because she is still considered to be his wife. So the talaq al-raj'i, the talaq al-ruj'a, this talaq which he's speaking about, this type of divorce, is the type of divorce wherein one talaq has been pronounced and the man has left the woman. However, before her idda period finishes, before her waiting period finishes, he takes her back. He's allowed to do that without having to start a new contract. So this is what the Imam is referring to, that this type of contract is allowed. Why? Because the contract is not a new contract. It's based upon that. It's based upon a continuation of the previous contract. There's a few more points to mention in this section pertaining to the forbidden matters, but I'm going to stop here inshallah. We'll continue next week inshallah with Allah's permission. But if anyone has any questions on these items that we've taken so far, then feel free. If not, we hope to see you next week inshallah. We will finish off the items pertaining to that which is forbidden for the person in the state of ihram, and then we will move on to speaking about Bab al-Fidya, speaking in detail about how we pay penalties for that which is done, for that item which is done if it's forbidden in the state of ihram. If anyone has any questions, then feel free. If not, we will see you next week, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you immensely inshallah.